Hello everyone, welcome back to the channel and to the very last episode of What TV Shows I Saw This Month, December 2023 edition. First and foremost, Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays to everyone that celebrates, and good luck on your upcoming New Year's resolutions. This is the season of giving back and going above and beyond, after all, for the ones you love, so being the good Samaritan that I am, I've blessed everyone with the longest episode of this series thus far to cap off this year with an extra special recap vid this month. So you better be extra grateful and share this one out with all your friends and family, like your grandma will share that awful Christmas card. You know, the one where your hair looks like it got caught up in Tornado Alley. I mean, I had to sit through so much bad TV for you bozos, the least you can do is leave a comment or something. That being said, this episode is bittersweet, seeing that it's the last one of these I'm gonna do. I'll go into more detail at the end of this video, as well as give an overview of what you can expect from the channel going into 2024. But for now, for one last time, let's jump straight into the shows, like Moe's jumped into bed with everybody who had a dick and a pulse. Yeah, at this point, I'm surprised they haven't inked a deal with Bang Bus the way they graphically detail nearly every encounter they had amongst themselves while on a middle school set, which, may I remind you, was named after a man who died from diarrhea, because there's nothing that gets the blood flowing quite like cholera. Just ask Hoodie Allen. Hoodie, oh geez, goddamn, look at all my followers, bitches ride the wagon, but I'd rather give her cholera. You know, I feel really bad for people whose job it is to actually record the music, because you never know who's gonna walk into that studio. Could be John Batiste laying down songs that'll eventually win him a Grammy, could be Dua Lipa cutting it up with a hot dance track, or it could be a man who chose the name Hoodie Allen in 2009 who makes songs like that. But I'd rather give her cholera. Anyway, getting back to the Neds podcast, I still thoroughly enjoy this show. It's always a blast to hear guests and their experiences on Nickelodeon or in the TV industry as a whole, and recently they've actually started reviewing the episodes of Neds once again, because, you know, it's a rewatch podcast, not a re-crotch podcast. This show might be ending, but the bad puns will never go away. But yeah, it's super cool to hear their experiences making the episodes and getting little tidbits and trivia each week. I do hope they continue it even after they've viewed all the Ned media out there, but please, no more sex talk. Because let's be real, if I wanted to hear people talk about balls for 45 minutes, I'd turn to the Mike and Andrew pod, a weekly sports pod hosted by my buddy Mike from the channel Mike's Talks and Thoughts and his pal Andrew, where they break down everything happening in the NFL and college football. As someone who enjoys sports but doesn't have the energy to keep up with all the insane shit that happens in the league week to week, it's really nice to know I can turn to these guys to give me a concise overview of what the hot topics are. Well, actually, thinking about it, I guess I could turn to these guys too, or these guys, or them, or I guess they do it the same way as well, and these guys do it too. And these guys, 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 and these guys. Alright, let's be honest. This show is not reinventing the wheel. There's already a litany of podcasts, talk shows, YouTube channels, blogs, Taylor Swift stan pages, and middle-aged deadbeat absentee dads who hang around the local sports bar from noon to 5:30 every weekday who could catch you up on anything you'd want to know in the sports world. The competitiveness of this industry makes it almost impossible to stand out for a small show like this one is. The only reason I know about it is because I'm friends with these dudes and heard about it through word of mouth. But trying to find this organically would be quite a challenge. It's a great time. Mike and Andrew clearly know their stuff and have wonderful chemistry with each other, and they have some good running gags that always get a chuckle out of me. But if you're already tapped into the sports world or already follow a podcast similar to this, I'm just not sure how much more you're gonna get out of this one. Still though, I enjoy it, and it's a nice counterpoint to the immense amount of TV and music-related content that I tend to consume. The Curse continues to blow me away with its twisted, unsettling atmosphere and stupendous performances from its leads, Emma Stone especially. That new Golden Globes body really knows their shit. Great sneak.
Even if they put it in the wrong fucking category.
As the story has unfolded, the more and more intriguing it becomes, and I really love the week-to-week release strategy for this series. It's very dense and gives you a lot to chew on, so I like how it allows time for everything to breathe. I'll be at work the next day randomly thinking about how they pulled off certain scenes, like the camera work and the long takes and everything. These folks are pros through and through. I'm just blown away how they never break character. If I were even just an extra, I'd be laughing like Jimmy fucking Fallon. And I just know the gag reel during the stove heist scene went fucking nuts. This show is absolutely wonderful and makes me want to watch nothing but cringe comedy for weeks. And I'm just saying, if Madison Bush or Parks and Rec randomly see big spikes in retention, y'all will know why. Amazing stuff, a must watch for all TV fans for sure. But do you want to know what was just cringe without the comedy? This fucking shit.
This episode of Wizards of Waverly Pod is brought to you by HelloFresh. Now, HelloFresh is so convenient. Whether your resolution is to save money, eat better, or stress less, HelloFresh is here to help you with all three.
Hi, Davey, you look like a fella that likes to eat, but shilling HelloFresh on Christmas Day? Someone's dyslexic, because that ain't Santa-like behavior. That's some full-on Satan shit. At least these two don't have any stories about, playing with his magic wand, if you catch my drift. They tend to actually stay on topic and chat some wizards, which is always entertaining. This month they had on some really cool guests like actress Kate Flannery, most known for being on The Office, and the leads from Disney's Mighty Med, Bradley Stevens Perry and Jake Short, all of whom had really neat stories about working on Disney and sharing their advice for up-and-comers looking to make it into the TV scene. As I've mentioned before, I personally watched more Neds growing up, so as a whole, I think that one's a bit stronger. But as the year has gone on, the Wizards one has really started to creep up there for me in terms of just being very reliable each week. That is, if we just ignore the HelloFresh ads. Seriously, they're a dog shit company with terrible morals. It is not a good look. Luckily, watching a few pieces from Last Week Tonight with John Oliver always turns that right around. I mean, the man who masterfully roasts figures like George Santos and Elon Musk in ways only Oliver can, as well as serious, nuanced discussions on topics like freight railways and organ donation, the latter of which featured one of the most beautiful, heartfelt segments the show has ever showcased, in the midst of a story that talks about dead bodies and where they end up. I'm telling y'all, they have a superpower, it's nuts. Y'all don't need me to say it, this show is incredible and one of TV's all-time greats. SNL had three new episodes this month featuring Emma Stone in another kick-ass performance, Kate McKinnon in a big return to form marking her first appearance since her departure last year, and what's that dude's name? The Vroom Vroom Man. Yeah, I'm gonna be 100% honest, I could have given a single fuck who hosted that night. They could have brought back Jackie Gleason from the dead and had him play his character from The Honeymooners for an hour and a half for all I care. Olivia Rodrigo made her sophomore appearance on the show and literally killed it, with probably the single best performance I've ever seen from the show. I'm not kidding, All American Bitch sounded fucking incredible. Rock isn't dead, y'all, it's just changing. I wasn't as big on her minimalist take on Vampire, but it was still very interesting. Not to mention, she actually got to appear in a live sketch, which is always super fun. Who knew the writers were Bizardvark fans? One semi-serious thing I'd like to mention real quick though is on that truly baffling cold open about the anti-Semitism congressional hearing, the one known by many as the worst one. Apparently Cecily Strong of all people was supposed to be in it, making what would have been her first appearance on the show since she left back in 2021. And, like, just what a bullet bill-sized bullet dodge there. Like, I'm a huge Cecily fan, probably a top 10 cast member of all time for me, and that being her return would have been very disappointing. That poor new girl is going to have to work twice as hard now to get credibility within the larger ensemble. That thing was a total mess. Honestly, the only somewhat funny part of the entire skit was Kenan Thompson, which is also something I could say about Good Burger 2, a movie that me and my brother watched in December. This is significantly better than Zoe 102, but since the bar for that movie was so far underground, Open Mike Eagle considers it obscure, that's not really saying much. It's interesting to see how much more effort and attention was put into this one, given all of the extended cameos and guest stars in this movie. Like, seriously, everybody you could imagine is in this thing. Mark Cuban, Kai Cenat, Young Gravy, Liza Koshy, Rob Gronkowski, and about half the cast of SNL and all that, as Kenan Thompson cashes in every favor he has. Word of advice, next time you're jammed during an intense match of 6 degrees of separation, turn to Good Burger 2. It'll get you out of that pickle in no time. I promise you, it's still better than half the jokes in this movie, which as a whole was trying way too hard to have some form of a message that felt about 15 years too late. The plot involves Good Burger getting sold to a megacorp and the iconic duo of Dexter and Ed having to stop them from monopolizing it, using the Good Burger name and completely dismantling the reputation they have by using automation instead of real workers. It's trying semi-political commentary in a way, but it just feels so dated and lackluster. Like, they had the idea for this movie about 20 years ago and just sat on it for some reason until they finally found an avenue to distribute it on. It's filled of a lot of the typical elements you've seen a million times already that results in a cliched mess that tastes undercooked. The leads' chemistry are fine, but stripped away from the nostalgia, it just feels forced and is basically the epitome of what these legacy sequels feel like nowadays. That being said, there were some positives. As mentioned before, Thompson always delivers the laughs here. His dry wit and sarcasm never fails in my opinion. And even though there were too many of them for my liking, the cameos are a nice pop of nostalgia. Whenever my parents watch a movie from like 1979 and they name drop everyone on screen as they're watching, that's what me and Matt were doing throughout this movie, and that was fun to see something that really felt like it was made for us, you know? Good Burger 2 is not a great movie, but it's not the worst thing I've ever seen either. You could watch it, but you're not missing much if you decide not to either. Like your average fast food burger, it is aggressively mid. I finally got around to finishing up Goosebumps on Disney Plus this month, and y'all, I have never been more confused in my life on a show's reception. Like, the numerous TV TikTok talking heads who had this at the bottom of their year-end rankings, I'm looking at you, Jess and Hope, is outrageous.
There's a lot of focus here on the teen melodrama and romances, and not in a way that I particularly cared for.
This is gonna piss some people off, but 5 out of 10. No.
Like, what's not to enjoy here? It's Stranger Things meets Final Destination with just a dash of Groundhog's Day based on Goosebumps, one of the best horror franchises out there. The characters? Excellent. Picking my favorite is nearly impossible. The action? Terrific. White knuckle in the best way possible. The emotional tugs? Outstanding. The way that you feel the peril of these people through the screen is unmatched. Justin Long? I mean, come on, the man is pulling off things I didn't even know were humanly possible. Like, straight up a top 3 performance of the year, no question. Like, I'm serious when I say I could talk about this show all day long. I absolutely loved it. Okay, there was one small thing that I didn't love. Just watch this. I mean, what the fuck was that? This lady does not drink Red Bull. She's never mentioned Red Bull. It seems very out of character for her. And this is during a very paramount scene for the story with a lot of tension and stakes at hand. And it's not like I drink Red Bull to begin with. I'm a sparkly nice energy guy for life. But there's no way you could discredit their creativity when it came to promo. Like how they give NPH free product for life just for being a fan. Or how they sponsor that dude who jumped from space. Yeah, remember that shit? That was them. So what the fuck happened to their PR team? They gotta settle for forced product placement on a kid's show now? What a load of bullshit. Goosebumps on Disney Plus, legitimately though, was awesome. It is high-octane escapism with a wonderful cast and crazy set pieces that will have you unnerved the way only they can pull off. I also watched the season's finale to the Marble League and... they lost. Like, how could that have happened? They were leading the whole time. They looked great coming into the race. It was supposed to be perfect. The streets would be filled with celebration of some Speeders fans chest bumping. It was theirs to lose, and they fucking lost to bees? Bees suck. They sucked back when one stung me while we were vacationing back in 08, and it hurt really bad, and they ruined my day, and they suck now for beating the Savage Speeders. And that's everything I watched this month. Oh wait, you thought we were done though? Nah, Chief, this is the long-awaited season finale. We have some unfinished business to attend to. What rank would I have all the new releases from this year in? If you recall, last year I did this in its own separate video, but since I've been cataloging all the new series I've seen from 2023 throughout this show, I figured it was only right to send it off with a master list. All 27 new debuts from the worst up to the best. I won't spend too much time on each one since, again, I've already given my 2 cents on all these over the course of these videos. If you want to know my thoughts in detail, the playlist for this show is in the description. That said, I'd like to add that as a whole, 2023 was a step up from 2022 in terms of quality. There weren't nearly as many train wrecks this year as there were in years prior. But the ceiling was also a bit lower. There was a solid amount of consistency interlaced throughout the year, which was fun to talk about, but it also allowed for a healthy amount of competition in terms of the order of the master rank in question. Don't take it too seriously, this is just my opinion, but feel free to share your rank in the comments. As I did last year, this is only going to cover new debuts, shows that began sometime this year with a pilot that aired between January 1st and December 31st. No seasons of TV like The Bear Season 2, for example, nothing that I saw for the first time that had previously aired, and no reboots that are extensions of the original series. So with that, the worst show of the year at number 27, Crapopolis. This is an unpopular opinion for it to be at the worst spot, but fellas, come on now. Number 26, Matt's Mystery Food Chase. Still somehow not the creepiest dude walking around New York City. Number 25, Velma. It's not that bad. I mean, the animation is ugly, the jokes don't land, the characters do not act how they should, the meta commentary isn't that meta, and I haven't returned to it since January. But it's not that bad. Number 24, That 90s Show. Yeah, I'm a guy who can separate the art from the artist. But I can also separate the shows worth your time versus the ones that aren't. Number 23, We Interrupt This Broadcast. There's a whole subreddit dedicated to Australian TV and how it sucks. No notes. Number 22, Cashback Kitchen. I didn't even pay for this and I want my cash back. Number 21, The Idol. It's not that bad. Frankly, the worst part about this show is how they gave Madonna the worst song of her entire career. Okay, maybe it is that bad. Number 20, Night Court. I watched the holiday special that aired recently with my dad, who hadn't seen this show before, and he described it as corny. And that's a perfect way of describing it, because after consuming it, it stays the exact same and doesn't change you in any way. Number 19, Wizards of Waverly Pod. Definitely grew on me over the year. Number 18, The Walking Dead Dead City. Definitely grew off me over the year. Number 17, Stardish. I don't know if I'd call them stars per se, but yeah, these ladies are entertaining. Number 16, Switch. I forgot I watched this one since it premiered so long ago, but I went back to remind myself what this one was all about, and yeah, it's solid. Very GSN, so take that as you will. Number 15, The Mike and Andrew Podcast. This was the second best pod of the year, and it was the best sports theme one. Take that as you will. Number 14, Swarm. The best things about this show, Billie Eilish, and the entirety of episode 7. The worst things about this show, the scenes without Billie Eilish, and the ones not in the style of episode 7. Number 13, La Mexa Mesa. Hell yeah, give the winners of MasterChef more of their own cooking shows. Fox, you're sitting on a gold mine here. Number 12, From Scratch with Teenie. Hell yeah, give the losers of Next Level Chef more of their own cooking shows. Fox, you're sitting on a gold mine here. Number 11, The Other Black Girl. I feel bad not putting this one in the top 10. It lost out by mere millimeters. This is really good stuff. And now... the top 10, beginning with Goosebumps. Great cast, great action, great comedy, great Justin Long. Seriously, how do you learn these things, Justin? Can you teach me? Number 9, based on a true story. Man, between this and The Flight Attendant, Kaley Cuoco should do more thriller comedy. No. I take that back. I take it back. Number 8, Ned's Declassified Podcast Survival Guide. I wanted to put a sex joke here, but that was too hard. I'm a comedy writer and this is my best work. That's probably why my subscriber count has stagnated over the years. Number 7, The Curse. This is when Nathan Fielder's schtick really clicked for me, and I am never looking back now. Number 6, Twisted Metal. I need 10 more seasons of this pronto. This was a great fucking year for video game-based shows. God damn. Number 5, Stars on Mars. I know it's cheesy, but I loved it. I am not above stupid reality trash TV, and neither should you be. Number 4, Jury Duty. After this show ended, they gave that dude Ronald a deal to star in more shows for Amazon. I don't know why. God, that makes me sound like I hated the show. It's number 4. No. I like the show. I'm just not sure if that's what he would have wanted, you know? He was just a normal guy who got transported into this crazy world of TV. What the fuck does Bezos have planned for this dude? Number 3, Beef. Man, this was amazing. I mean, no wonder. It's made by A24. They never miss. They almost never miss. Number 2, The Walking Dead, Daryl Dixon. The best Walking Dead show in a very long time. Legit up there with some of the best material from the original series. This is a true television masterpiece. But it does come up a little bit short to my number 1, which is The Last of Us. Because... duh.
See this here? Ooh. And the handheld mic. Wow, that is... okay, that's way too dark. Yeah, that's not gonna work at all. Damn, that's darker than the average man at a U.S. prison. Okay, that's a bit better. Doesn't have to be, like, crazy, but... my hair... should have gone back to the dark. It would have been better. You wouldn't have been able to see how bad my hair looks right now. For those of you who made it to this far in the video, thank you so very much. You are absolutely awesome. I appreciate you sticking with me. And I also appreciate the fact that you just sat through a litany of horrible, unfunny jokes and you still decided to see what my goofy ass had in store. You are a real trooper, my friend, and you deserve a fucking medal. This last part was originally supposed to be its own video, and originally I wanted to go like really in-depth and kind of give you a really detailed overview of what's going to happen going forward, but I also like the mystery of it a little bit, so I'm not going to take up too much more of your time. I'm going to make this really quick, really straight to the point, because I don't really even know myself what it's going to look like, so trying to like bullshit my way through it didn't really make sense. Here are the important parts you need to know. The last couple months, I have been feeling very tired of making YouTube videos, like physically tired. Like I've lost sleep and I just wasn't in good health and I just need a break from it. I love making videos. I'm not gonna stop making videos, but for at least a few weeks, I'm gonna take some time off and recalibrate a bit so that when I come back, I'm recharged. I can jump right back into it and get started, hit the ground running, make some fucking killer videos. Because I don't know if you can tell, but I really love making these videos, man. Videos are one of my favorite things to do. It's a pastime of mine, it's a hobby that I do on the side. I don't get paid for this, this is not my full-time job, but it's just a passion that I've had since I was a kid. And now actually being able to do it and coming up on 5 years of it is just mind-blowing, which is crazy. And especially these types of videos to make, these more elaborate, sort of like in-depth with a lot of editing and a lot of scripting and production value and stuff. These are like my all-time favorites to do, especially this series where it's usually just a springboard for me to just make stupid jokes and just like poke fun at shit. Like, it's not even like real like commentary. It's not even meant to be like real critiques. It's just a springboard just to make people laugh and just make them feel good. That's always what I've tried to do on my channel. My date that I'm gonna try to come back is January 26th. That'll be a Friday. And you may be thinking, well, why Friday? Don't you usually upload videos on Tuesday and Friday? Well, I used to, but I'm not going to anymore. I'm going to cut it down to one video a week exclusively on Friday. The two videos a week schedule, though, it's starting to feel a little hectic at times, and it's starting to get a little insane just by my own ambitions, more or less. I mean, I could keep doing them, but at this point in my YouTube career, if you want to call it that, I'm not that interested in making just basic A to Z videos anymore, literally or figuratively in that respect. Like, I don't really feel like I want to make videos that are just basic reviews, you know, or just basic tier lists. The tier lists that I made all throughout this year were, again, just springboards to do like comedy with and just have fun with, you know, a little more avant-garde, a little more experimental stuff. That's the stuff that I like to watch on YouTube. That's the stuff that really inspires me. I don't really want to watch just very simple critiques anymore. I mean, no disrespect to the people that make those types of videos here. You know, that's obviously a great niche to fill, and there's a time and a place for all of it. But that's the beauty of YouTube, and that's the reason why I don't feel like it's worth my time much anymore, is just because there's so many other more ambitious, more unique, more interesting things to do that have their place here, that if you're not exploring those spaces, then you're kind of wasting that opportunity, you know? I've always considered myself a creative person and a somewhat ambitious person. I like to make a lot of things in a lot of different mediums. I like to write, I like to make videos, I like to cook. Those are all very creative endeavors. Those are all arts. And at this point, all those basic ideas, all those basic categories of things or basic premises for videos, I've already done at this point. And there's not really a lot left to explore in those avenues. Basically done all the tier lists, all the compilations that I want to do. Of course, that's what I got famous for, compilations, famous in quotes, I got, you know, popular for, and those are some of my most viewed videos, and I don't really have any plans on making those types of videos anymore. Frankly, they're just not that interesting to me. The types of videos that I hope to make every week in 2024 are going to be a little more elaborate, a little more involved. And these are video topics that I've been sitting on, that I've had on the back burner for some of them literally years, that I've wanted to talk about, but I never found the right time to do so. As always as well, just trying to, you know, be a little bit more social, always hearing from you guys is great. So whatever ideas you have or whatever topics you want to see explored, if you have any suggestions, you can always leave comments and stuff. I always try to take suggestions and turn them into videos because I appreciate that you guys watch, and I know that's a great way to connect with you guys. And more collabs for anybody that is interested in it. I know me and Mike were talking about, we have some more ideas planned for the Album Ring series that we'll definitely get to, because that is just a ton of fun to do with, you know, someone else and really, you know, hone in on it together. The other thing I want to mention is, in addition to that, I'm going to be launching a new channel probably within the next week or so. I don't have any immediate plans to upload on there, at least in January. It'll probably be a month or two before I actually get around to making videos on there, but it is going to expand outside of just me talking about TV and music, and finally, for the first time ever, have a dedicated spot to talk about film. Because in addition to TV and music, I love talking about movies, and I have a lot of them that I've always wanted to say something on, that like have funny things to talk about that I can do bits to, and now I finally have a dedicated spot to do that. So in the description, I've launched a brand new channel there. I will probably make a video kind of explaining why I did it on a separate channel within the next couple weeks, and then actually post the, you know, videos about movies about a month or two after that. So go ahead and go subscribe down there. It's called NVG Nick Chats About Flicks. Because I'm very creative. I love everybody that comes by and watches my goofy ass make shitty jokes. Absolutely appreciate every single one of you, whether you've just, you know, been here for a couple weeks or you've been here for a couple years. Regardless, it is just amazing that I have the opportunity to entertain you guys and inspire you and do all sorts of crazy shit here that I would never even dream I could do otherwise. It's unbelievable. Thank you so much. But yeah, that's basically the overview of it. I know this has been a hectic year, and I'm sure some of you probably had it way different circumstances than I did. There were some great things about 2023. There were some pretty awful things about 2023 that everyone, you know, naturally goes through. But yeah, that's about it there. Thank you again for watching. Happy New Year, everybody. Good luck on your resolutions. I know for me, my resolutions are about this channel, making it the best it can possibly be. So let's all stand, you know, in support of one another. And for the last time, at least for a while, thank you guys for watching once again. Take care. I'll see you next time.